cells also come from somites, but they don't develop into muscle right away. They're kind of like late bloomers. And what happens is they get activated whenever our body needs more muscle. And that can be for several different reasons. You could be going through puberty and growing that way. You could be working out a lot and getting big muscles that way. You could be injuring yourself, tripping and falling, and you need to repair yourself. Doesn't matter really the instance. In reality, what's going on is you're causing a break in this muscle fiber. So when this happens, your satellite cells, which are normally kind of hibernating in a quiescent stage, they get activated. And when they activate, they undergo two different types of growth. The first phase of growth involves them rapidly doubling in numbers, and we call this proliferation. After they proliferate, they undergo something called differentiation, terminal differentiation, where they actually fuse together and form myotubes, which in turn can help repair this muscle, fill in the gap, and make it big and bigger and better than it was before. So now that we understand the potential for using satellite cells to actually make muscle inside the body, let's talk about how we can use them to make muscle outside the body. So when I first started my research, I decided to develop a cell bank of a cell line of muscle satellite cells from a turkey, because people like to eat turkey and there aren't really a lot of farm animal muscle cell lines out there. So I began with a biopsy from a turkey. This biopsy was about the size of half of the size of a grain of rice, and it contained around 12 million satellite cells. And I do want to point out that this can be done by a veterinarian under anesthesia, using pain medication, and the animal can wake up afterwards and go on its merry way. So after we took this biopsy, the isolation was then moved into cell culture flasks that exhibit a kind of similar environment that the cells would see inside the body. As you can see here, they like to attach down, so they're kind of attaching down to the bottom of these cell culture flasks. So from there, once they got accustomed to living in culture, I starved them. I gave them media without any growth factors in it. And what that did was it killed a lot of them, but it also selected for an extremely robust and homogeneous cell line. So from there, I eventually did feed them, and I did that every 48 hours, not 47, not 49, every 48 hours until they reached around 80% confluent. And when I say that, I mean that about 80% of the bottom of the dish was filled with satellite cells. Now, if I let them go to around 90%, 95%, you can see here that they're actually starting to line up, and in that situation, they're actually switching over from proliferation to the differentiation stage. And when you're developing a cell bank, you don't really want that. You do want that when you're making meat, but that's not what I was doing yet. So then I took an enzyme that was able to remove the cells off the bottom of the dish, and taking those cells, I then stored them in cryogenic storage in a whole bunch of little vials, or I just used them to repeat the process by replating them down on the cell culture flask. So I did this for about 6 months, and I ended up with around 70 to 75 vials of these cells. And now I want to talk to you guys about what we can do with these cells, this cell line. It's called the MG1 cell line. It's a turkey muscle cell, and yes, it is named after me. So satellite cell utility in general. For one, they grow very quickly in culture. We're talking around 24 hours. Another cool thing is that they will form myotubes really easily. These MG1 cells, all you have to do is remove growth factors and make sure that they're really, really crowded, and they'll differentiate into myotubes. They can also grow in serum-free media. Now, there's a lot of formulations out there already, and I'm personally working on a serum-free media that utilizes liver cells, which is a type of digestive cell, taking the growth factors from that and then giving it to my muscle cells, and I've got the cost down to around $4 a liter, so hopefully that's got some scaling potential later on. Another cool thing is applicable pluripotency, and what that means is that these satellite cells, not only can they differentiate into muscle, but they can differentiate into things like fat and bone and connective tissue, which, as we all know, play a very big part in meat. So it's possible that we could actually make meat not just from a single, not just in the lab, but from a single source, a single cell source. Satellite cells in general will also express telomerase, which is a protein that's necessary for maintaining DNA integrity during cell division and has been linked to longevity in culture. Another cool thing is that satellite cells are able to adhere and proliferate on plant-based scaffolds. This is a jackfruit turkey nugget that I made recently, and the cells are able to attach down, and it would give earlier products and prototypes of a more of a meaty texture and appearance that can be brought on by the jackfruit, while the turkey cells can kind of add on to the flavor and the protein. And something that I'm really excited about, guys, is that they are growing in suspension, okay? So we'll talk about that in just a minute, but my muscle satellite cells are able to grow in suspension without any sort of microcarriers. So, but first, I want to talk a little bit about numbers. So we know where they come from in the body, we know how to grow them and establish a cell line, and we know how amazing they can be in order to use for making meat. But now I want to talk about their potential for scale. So satellite cells undergo something called exponential growth. And what happens is you start with one cell, that cell turns into two turns to four turns to eight. Okay, great. So we've got eight cells after 4 days. Wow. But what about after 3 months? After 3 months of this exponential growth, we could theoretically end up with around 6.19 times 10 to the 26 cells. So I'm going to go ahead and put that in perspective. This is a micro nugget that I made during my spare time, just for fun, because why not? It contains around 5 million cells, and it weighs around 0.1 grams. Now, when you compare that to a traditional McNugget that you can get at a drive-thru, that's about 17.5 grams, which is going to equate out to around 100 or 875 million satellite cells. But what about if we use the 90 cell division? So with that, we have around 8.19 times 10 to the 26 cells, which theoretically, we could end up over a 3 month period with over 12 trillion tons of turkey muscle. And with the World Health Organization estimating that around 376 million tons of meat will be produced in the year 2030, we're looking at the ability to make 33 times the annual meat production estimate by the year 2030. Now, obviously, this is all theoretical, and I know what you're thinking. If this is possible, then why are we not swimming in turkey muscle right now? And the answer is we're working on it. There's still a lot of things we need to address. We need to find sufficient cell culturing mechanisms, optimum growth conditions. And I think that one thing that we also definitely need to address is the fact that we can't grow over 12 trillion tons of muscle in petri dishes. Instead, we need to focus on something a little bit more like this. You guys know what this is? It's a fermenter that you see in breweries. So the idea is that we'll eventually be able to be brewing meat, just like we brew beer. So suspension growth offers a lot of advantages. For one, you have better nutrient dispersion when compared to adherent cell growth. You also get better oxygen transfer. Additionally, you have more room to grow because they're moving from a 2D surface over to a 3D environment. They've got a lot more places to move around to. And the other really exciting thing is that it's very scalable. But before we can actually move our cells into growing in these 500 liter reactors or even bigger, we need to start small. And that's what I'm doing right now. So these are 125 milliliter shake flasks in my little incubator. But what I'm finding inside is really exciting. It's the myospheres. See, I told you I was gonna talk about these again. So myospheres, in addition to offering several of the benefits that adherent satellite cells have, such as being able to differentiate into myotubes, grow in serum-free media, and then also differentiate into things like bone and fat, they also grow twice as long in culture when compared to satellite cells that are adherent. Another cool thing is that they actually express stem cell markers. You can see up here the BCRP1 and the SCA1, those are all stem cell markers that they express. Now, there are still some things that we need to address in myosphere scale-up. As you can see from this picture here, they're really still they're in aggregate form, and this can bring about some issues that we need to address. For one, we need to figure out a way to make sure that the cells that are inside the myospheres have optimum nutrient dispersion, because if they're inside the myospheres, they're gonna be behaving differently because they're exposed to a different environment. Another thing is once these myospheres get too big, the guys on the inside aren't really going to be able to have access to any nutrients. And so in order to break them down, we need to use filtration methods and digestive enzymes, and that takes time and money that we really shouldn't be using in this process. And finally, because they are aggregating and adhering to each other, that could lead to differentiation, which in turn could also decrease telomerase expression. So what I'm really focused on right now is getting my cells to grow in single cell suspension, which involves taking my cultures that look like this and making them look a little bit more like this. So that one day, this, and this, and this, and this can look a little bit more like this. Thank you very much.